So now that we have a good sense of how these chemical signaling molecules sort of classify themselves out in terms of the different classes that we see them in, either as a local regulator or as a hormone, we're now going to be moving forward into a new idea. And this new idea is one of the more confusing and complex parts of endocrinology, but it's very important to understand if you want to understand the real function, the physiology behind a chemical signal and how it works. So we're going to be entitling the next flowchart a cellular response pathway. And this is going to be part one of this, because there are going to be two ways that we're going to be looking at cellular response pathways. And the first way to look at this is through the initial sort of message that's being sent by a water-soluble hormones. So water-soluble hormones will have their own specific cellular response pathway, and that's going to be broadly termed as signal transduction. So in order for a water-soluble hormone, an aqueous environment hormone, to send a message within the cell, there needs to be something known as signal transduction that occurs. Now, signal transduction involves a series of different steps that we'll get to. But for right now, in terms of a bit of background, I want to sort of lay out some groundwork in terms of water-soluble hormone cell response pathways. So what we're going to be seeing in the next following steps is very much a series of changes in cellular proteins that can get very complex very quickly, but we'll work through it step by step. Series of changes in cellular proteins. So we're going to be seeing a big time series of events. But remember this goal, okay? This is something you have to keep in mind when looking at this complex cellular pathway. The goal is very simple. You want to turn an extracellular signal, extracellular chemical signal. That's a better way to define this, extracellular chemical signal into a very specific intracellular, so now we're within the cell, intracellular response. So let's look at this one more time. We want to take a message that's on the outside, an extracellular chemical signal, a hormone, and turn that hormone's message into a specific interior intracellular response, as we'll see. Okay, so keep this goal in mind. Hopefully we can succeed and reach this goal through the following steps. So there are several steps involved in this signal transduction pathway of water-soluble hormones. So first and foremost, what we have to sort of establish is the following. Step one. We have to understand that a hormone must be present. And a hormone becomes present through secretion. So a hormone, we'll say, is secreted via a process known as exocytosis. So a hormone is made, it's synthesized and secreted at a certain cell, at a certain tissue or a gland, and once it's made, it's exocytosed. It's released from the cell, and that hormone, remember, is water-soluble. And because it's water-soluble, it can then freely travel in blood. So we'll write that down as freely travels in blood. Remember that whole idea of being in an aqueous environment? This is critical here because the hormone itself is water-loving. It's hydrophilic hormone. It has polar functional groups. It has hydrophilic functional groups, and thus it can just go straight into the blood without any problems because, of course, it is water soluble, like dissolves like. So it's going to stay within the blood. Blood is mostly water, and thus it has no problem with this. But it does have a major problem with something else. It's soluble in water, it's soluble in blood, thus it can move in blood to far distances, but it's actually insoluble at its location that it needs to get to. It's insoluble in lipids, okay? And remember, the location is a target cell, and that's specifically the target cell receptor. And that would mean that this insoluble in lipid structure would mean that it cannot, a hormone that's water soluble, can't go across a plasma membrane. It cannot freely diffuse through a plasma membrane because it is hydrophilic. And the plasma membrane, though it has those hydrophilic heads, what about those hydrophobic tails? It's going to have incredible difficulty. It just cannot freely diffuse through those hydrophobic tails. So now we have a problem. Though we've reached the cell because we freely travel through the blood, how are we going to get into the cell? Are we going to get into the cell? We're actually not going to, because this is a signal transduction pathway. And that's step two of this stepwise scenario. Step two is that the hormone doesn't enter the cell because it can't. It's not supposed to. There's a different way that we can still take an extracellular chemical signal, the hormone, and result in a specific intracellular response. So let's write this verse down as hormone doesn't enter cell. Okay, that's pretty sad. So how are we supposed to do this? How are we supposed to send this message into the cell? What it does is the hormone instead binds to a specific membrane receptor. So it's going to bind to, just like we stated before, it binds to a specific membrane, MEM for membrane receptor. And once binded to that receptor, it then binds with, that hormone receptor complex will bind with something called a G protein, a G protein coupled receptor. So we have two steps that are happening simultaneously. Hormone doesn't enter the cell. It binds to a specific membrane receptor, and then immediately that hormone receptor complex binds to something known as a G protein coupled receptor. So that's step two. Let's take a look now at step three. Step three involves the following. So now we have this hormone receptor complex that's formed. So let's write that down. Hormone receptor dash receptor complex has been formed. Okay, that's good because we're getting somewhere. We're about to try to send a message. That receptor complex, just like I said over here, we'll just reiterate, binds to a G protein, binds to something called a G, capital G, dash protein. And that G protein is within the membrane. It's very closely related to the membrane because right now the hormone is at the membrane. It just can't go through the membrane. So it has to utilize something that can work with it, at least at the membrane level. And that's the G protein that's already within the membrane. Now, what you have to understand about G proteins is the following. G protein is an inactive form, usually. It's an inactive protein if bound to GDP, not gross domestic product, but GDP, okay? This is an energy molecule. And if it's bound to GDP, it cannot do its job as a G protein. But it can be unbound to GDP if it is bound to a hormone receptor complex. Hormone receptor complex formed binds to G protein. That means now the GDP will go away because what's going to happen is we're going to form a receptor plus G protein complex. That would mean that the G protein then changes into an active form. So say receptor plus G protein complex immediately gives us an active form of the G protein. Active form of the G protein means that the GDP is gone. So we'll say that the GDP is released. That's that thing that's been holding us back as a G protein. Then when GDP is released, G protein then binds to a different energy molecule called GTP. So now the G protein no longer has GDP. It now binds to GTP. That causes the G protein then to do the following last thing. The G protein changes conformation. G protein changes conformation. Now, when we say conformation, this simply means that the G protein changes its shape. So I'll write that down on the side over here. It changes its shape. It has a conformational shape change. Why? Because it's bound to GDP. GTP, how did it bind to GTP? Well, that's because it released GDP. How did it release GTP? Well, that's because it became active. Why did it become active? Because it bound to a hormone receptor complex, forming this structure here. Cool. Now we have everything necessary to begin an intracellular response. The hormone has reached the G protein, has talked the G protein into becoming an active form. Now we're going to have a lot of steps go by very, very quickly. So pay attention here. Here we go. So step four, we're going to go down the line here. Step four would be that the shape change, the shape of the G protein changes, right? We know that. That's from our previous step. But this is going to cause the following. Now we're going to have the following binding. The structure, that's the G protein and hormone receptor complex structure, binds to a molecule called adenyl cyclase. So we have an A-S-E ending. Adenyl cyclase then, C-Y-C-L-A-S-E, is a membrane-bound enzyme. Write that down as sort of a side note. It's a membrane-bound enzyme, A-S-E ending. So that means this enzyme is activated because it has now been bound to this structure that we formed in step three. So we're going to say that in the next step five. AC for adenylene cyclase now activated because it's been bound to something that it wants to be bound to. Remember, enzymes need a very specific environment, and the specific environment here is binding to what was produced in step three. AC now activated, it does a very important job of a conversion. It converts the molecule that we know and love called ATP, which is a chemical energy molecule, to a different chemical energy molecule called cyclic AMP, C-A-M-P. Now, this is a huge step. Step five is a huge step because it leads to step six. Of course it does. Step six is the following. What you have to know about CAMP is that even though it's been converted from ATP, once it's in the CAMP form, it acts as what we call a second messenger. Now that might probe you to ask, what was the first messenger? The first messenger was simply this hormone. The hormone was a chemical signaling molecule. It was a messenger that initiated all these steps. Now CAMP has been activated, was ATP, it's turned into CAMP. It can now send a second intracellular message because the hormone couldn't come into the cell. So now it uses the CAMP as sort of a second messenger that activates a different molecule. This now activates something called protein kinase. So another enzyme, right? A-S-E ending. So now this enzyme needs CAMP. How did it get CAMP? Because step 5 happened, because step 4 happened, because step 3 happened, etc. So what is protein kinase in this story of signal transduction? 7 is our final step here. We're going to have protein kinase, which I'll just abbreviate from this point forward after I write it one more time as PK. Protein kinase phosphorylates things. That's its job. Number 7 is phosphorylation, essentially. So protein kinase phosphorylates things. What does phosphorylation mean? It means it adds phosphorus groups onto things. When you have phosphorylation happen, when you phosphorylate things, when you add phosphate groups to things, the purpose of this is activation, further activation. Phosphorylation, I'll say, is equal to activation. And what are we specifically activating right now? We are going to be activating a specific enzyme. An enzyme gets activated, so I'll say an enzyme gets phosphorylated, better word. Enzyme gets phosphorylated by PK. Phosphorylated by protein kinase, PK. How did it do that? Well, that's because protein kinase got activated by CAMP. So enzyme gets phosphorylated by protein kinase. Now that enzyme, because it just got a phosphorus group, has been activated. So now we have an activated enzyme in step 7. It's been activated. This is a form of post-translational control that we see on proteins. And this activation then finally leads to a response. This is amazing that this is how a hormone that cannot get into the cell extracellular chemical signal eventually leads to a specific intracellular response. This enzyme is in the cell, and it's going to give us an intracellular response in step 7. This is a very complex signal transduction pathway that I understand can be confusing and daunting, but you absolutely need to look at figure 45.5 and 45.6.